I'm a mathematical physicist, and I came to the IHES in 1964. How did I choose to come here? Well, let me start at the beginning. My university studies took place in Belgium, which was then my home country. I started with 2 years of civil engineering, then proceeded to physics and mathematics, and ended up with a PhD in physics from the Free University of Brussels in 1959. Actually, I had spent time at the ETH, the Federal Institute of Technology in Zurich, before and after my PhD, and that's where my scientific research career really started. In 1962, I moved for 2 years to the Institute for Advanced Study in Princeton, New Jersey, in the United States. And then, at the end of these 2 years, I could either stay in the US or go back to Zurich. But another possibility opened up, which was a new institute called IHES in Bures-sur-Yvette. My wife was in favor of Bures because it was in France, and I accepted a permanent position there. As I arrived here, I found that the place was fantastically good from a scientific point of view and very pleasantly located. However, the financial situation was bordering on the catastrophic. But it didn't bother me too much because science in those days was rather different from what it has become. In fact, there were few research scientists and there was a lot of money for science. So I moved to the IHES, which was a great place, but I kept ready to jump to another country if the IHES should collapse. This attitude has served me well throughout my career. I want to talk about the golden period at the Institut des Hautes Études Scientifiques. Have I known golden periods in other places? Well, I have been in the academic world for over 60 years in various countries, and I have seen a number of normally good places and a few great ones. The difference is that in great places, I really felt pushed forward intellectually by interactions with other people. It may happen that a single scientist creates a great place around him in his field of competence. That was the case with Rees Joost in quantum field theory in Zurich in the 1960s. And it still is the case now with Joe Liebowitz in statistical mechanics at Rutgers University. However, a multidisciplinary great place may also arise when several scientists share the responsibility of scientific organization. A superb example was the Institute for Advanced Study in Princeton. When I visited there from 1962 to 64. At that time, T.D. Lee, C.N. Yang, Freeman Dyson, Robert Oppenheimer, and others were around in physics. Another superb example was the IHES when I joined Alexander Grothendieck, René Thom, and Louis Michel as a permanent member there in 1964. So-called permanent members were the name given at the IHES to the faculty, and there were also temporary visitors. Unfortunately, great places need not stay great forever. For instance, when I went back to the Institute for Advanced Study in Princeton in 1970-71, there was a dispute raging between physicists and mathematicians, and the place for me was no longer great. At the IHES, there was also a period of crisis in 1970, which is when Grundig left. But apart from that, the IHES has enjoyed several decades of greatness. This is what I think of as the golden period of the IHES, and that's what I'm going to talk about. What makes a place great rather than just good? Well, first you have to start with good people. Since I'm one of those people I describe as good, this may sound a bit arrogant, but let me say that at the time that I'm discussing, the permanent members at the IHES were all known internationally for their work and had international connections that were very useful to get people invited. The permanent members of the IHES were certainly not mediocre at this time, and let me say that as of now, they are still not mediocre. The IHES permanent members still form a group that can be compared without disadvantage to the faculty at the Institute for Advanced Study in Princeton. And let me add that Léon Motchan, the first director and creator of the IHES, was certainly also not a mediocre person. The IHES started with good people, but there's no simple recipe to ensure that you will obtain a great place. At the beginning, the IHES had one great asset. Following the model of the Institute for Advanced Study in Princeton, the scientific decisions were taken by the faculty. This means that the permanent members used their international connections to seek out, well, established good people and new talents to visit the IHES in Bures-sur-Yvette. The quality of people who came is impressive. For instance, Jean-Pierre Serre and Irving Siegel stayed here for a year. My wife has a list of those people we had for dinner at home. This includes Freeman Dyson, Eugene Wigner, Rudolf Peierls, and many, many more. This was an impressive period. Well, an able administrator will ask specialists to rate application lambda versus application lambda prime. But one can do better than that. Forget about lambda, lambda prime, and seek out double capital A. The early IHES permanent members were not specialists. Grothendieck pointedly said that he was a generalist, not a specialist. So when the decisions of scientific policy were taken after discussion between the competent people who would implement these decisions, you obtained a coherent program. Where an able administrator could take decisions that follow the fashion, the decisions reached by the permanent members of the IHES were ahead of fashion. It's not easy at all to make the right choices of scientific policy. Going ahead of fashion means that you risk to be wrong. But if you just follow fashion, then you are certain to remain somewhat mediocre. There were heated discussions between the permanent members and the director in what was then the scientific committee of the IHES, which took the scientific decisions. And it is tempting to remove these heated scientific discussions to avoid trouble. But then one is likely to remove the greatness of the science one is trying to get going. Let me try to say briefly what I got out of the IHES golden period. When I came to the IHES, I was working in equilibrium statistical mechanics, which is an area of theoretical physics, which has a remarkably rich underlying mathematical structure. In particular, with Dobrushin and Lanford, we obtained a local global understanding of the infinite volume equilibrium states of statistical mechanics, and the name DLR equation was later introduced to describe our result. I wrote two books on the structure of equilibrium statistical mechanics. At the same time, I did something completely different, namely, I listened to talks by René Thom on differentiable dynamical systems, and I also interacted with Steve Smale and his collaborators who taught me the theory of hyperbolic dynamical systems. So two completely different subjects. And then a miracle occurred. The Russian Yasha Sinai found a deep relation between equilibrium statistical mechanics and hyperbolic dynamics based on what he called Markov partitions. This opened a whole new field in which I had the competence to work. I introduced the concept of transfer operators, contributed to the study of Sinai, Roel, Bowen measures, and so on. These were important for the understanding of hydrodynamic turbulence and later led to the theory of chaos. And this, in a nutshell, is what I did during the golden years of the IHES. Let me explain the place and role of the IHES in those days in relation to French science and also more internationally. The statutes of the IHES did not indicate any specific role in French science. This role emerged from personal relations of the permanent members with French colleagues, and the relation was different actually for physicists and mathematicians. In mathematics, there were a series of talks, the Seminaire Thom, the Seminaire Grothendieck, and later the Seminaire de Ligne, which were well attended by people from Orsay, Paris, and also international visitors like Steve Smale and Barry Mazer. Grothendieck and later de Ligne had a number of students, collaborators, which were either French or coming from abroad. In physics, the situation was a bit different. There was a common seminar, which I started and was soon joined by Louis Michel and later other permanent members. This was more like a physics colloquium in a very wide sense. We asked talks from all kinds of international visitors to the Paris area. Benoît Mandelbrot being a typical example. The physics seminar were also well attended by people from Orsay, Saclay, etc., who came whenever the speaker or the title of the talk interested them. There was also an intense collaboration and interaction between the permanent members and the international visitors. The DLR equations that I mentioned earlier were a result from my collaboration with Oscar Landford, who was then a visitor. And D is for Dobrushin, who could not leave the Soviet Union, but we corresponded with him and exchanged publications. I was a colleague of Grundig at the IHS for several years. What can I say about him? Grundig was one of several examples of people who made remarkable contributions, extraordinary contributions to science, and had otherwise a difficult life. I think of Galileo or Turing. The way in which Grundig abandoned mathematics also reminds me of the poet Arthur Rimbaud, who abandoned a literary career for some obscure traffic in East Africa. One could also mention Newton and his various extra-scientific preoccupations. The names just mentioned indicate a life centered not on pursuing a successful career, but on trying to understand something general which was important to those people. At this moment, let me interrupt the discussion of this of Grundig with a personal story. Early in my career, I received a letter asking if I would accept a certain little scientific prize. I answered politely, saying, in my opinion, thanks but no thanks. I didn't care for scientific prizes. Then, a little later, after having forgotten about this prize, I got another letter saying, congratulations, you won the X prize, and I felt that I couldn't refuse it. Later, I progressively understood that if you want to make a career in high-level research, you have to accept prize, become member of academies, and so on. That's not what I had in mind when I started doing science, but that's how it turned out to be. Grundig would say that I got corrupted. Now, more interesting for me than scientific prizes were hiking trips that I took in mostly alone in remote parts of Mexico, Iran, Ecuador, and so on. And these were important experiences for me. But when I talked about those trips to colleagues, they often thought that I was boasting about physical prowesses, which was absolutely not the case. So I refrained from talking about these hiking trips and also about reading Abélard's Historia Calamitatum in Latin, or other things that were important for me, but that I understood I'd better not talk about. In this way, I have survived better in the scientific world than Grundig or Galileo or Turing. And this is not because I was scientific better, but because perhaps I was a trifle more prudent. Let me return to Grundig. He was the son of a Russian anarchist who was traded during the Second World War by the French authorities to the German authorities and killed in Auschwitz. on top of being an anarchist, he was also a Jew. Now, Grothendieck himself was not an active anarchist, but you can understand that he lacked the healthy respect for authorities, which keeps you out of trouble. Politically, he was incredibly naive. Having personally interacted with Grothendieck, studied some small part of his mathematics, and read part of his non-mathematical writings, I think I have a unified view of who he was. He wrote, "For my whole life, my ambition as a mathematician, or rather my joy and passion, have constantly been to discover evident things." The person who wrote that was the same person who was incredibly naive politically. The person with the power of decision to create whole new branches of mathematics is also the same person who had little respect for authorities. The person who spent days and nights developing a new mathematical world is also the person who quit mathematics and spent his time doing what he called meditation, which actually meant writing. Grothendieck did not leave mathematics and become insane. He pursued a life quest which was essential to him.